this video segment, what I'd like to talk about is the term greenwashing. The origins of the word greenwashing come from being structurally similar to the word whitewashing. Now, whitewashing historically was a way of painting something white using a material instead of paint that was called whitewash. One of our cultural touch points for this phrase comes from the story of Tom Sawyer, who famously got friends of his to whitewash a picket fence for him instead of doing it himself. And the way he got people to do that was the subject of the story. But the whitewashing itself was like painting the fence white, but it was using an inferior and cheaper coating than paint. And it was just something that people did when they couldn't afford high quality paint. Well, over time, that became a metaphor in the political realm, whitewashing, and it became a derogatory way of calling out a politician for trying to deliberately conceal or hide some unpleasant fact about a person or an organization using some phrase or some technique of rhetoric to sort of whitewash over that issue. Oh, that politician is just whitewashing over the scandal by saying that it didn't happen. So it was a derogatory term for covering something up and trying to make some problem go away. Well, greenwashing is roughly the same thing, but it's in an environmental context. It's used as a derogatory term against companies or products or initiatives when the person who's calling it greenwashing feels that what the company or organization is doing is diverting attention away from what the real environmental concern might be. In 1999, the term greenwashing was added to the Oxford English Dictionary, and the definition was from green, meaning not ecologically harmful, and on the pattern of whitewash, as we just saw. And the definition would be disinformation disseminated by an organization so as to present an environmentally responsible public image for that organization. All right. So here are some examples of things that could be considered greenwashing depending on the context in which it takes place. The first and most famous one is the hotel towel cards that you see sometimes when you're staying at a hotel. Another one would be paperless billing, and a third one would be reusable grocery bags. Let me explain what I mean by how these things are greenwashing. So let's start with the hotel placard. So, you know, the idea here, the observation here, is that when a hotel asks you to reuse a towel by putting these placards there, so what the placard says is it says, if you would like to save our environment, rather than us washing your towels every day, just hang up your towels again and we won't wash them. If you do want them washed, leave them on the floor or in the tub, and our house cleaning employees will take those things and wash them. But we won't wash them daily, as was our current practice or our previous practice, because that's bad for the environment because it uses detergent and water. So the hotel places a little cardboard placard there in your room so that you can participate in this practice. So the observation here is that when the hotel asks you to reuse the towel, it isn't motivated after a well-thought-out approach to sustainability because it happens to directly coincide with the hotel's economic benefit. So while it's not inaccurate that saving towels and not washing them benefits the environment, it does. It just happens to be that that green measure, that environmental action, directly coincides with lower costs to the hotel. So this is greenwashing because it asserts that there's an environmental motivation for doing something that could just as easily be economically motivated. So for the hotel to justify that what they're doing is really out of an ecological concern or an environmental concern, they would have to demonstrate that they're not just doing things as an initiative to stop your towels. They should talk about how much water they're using in order to water their grounds, or how they're managing their back of house services, where perhaps more of an environmental impact is being made and where it may not directly coincide with lowering costs for the hotel. So the greenwashing, one example of greenwashing, and the first one that was called out were these hotel placards. So another one is paperless billing. Now, you may have several kinds of organizations that at one point were willing to offer you paper billing, or by default offer you paper billing, and then very quickly ask you or encourage you to go green, go paperless. And by that they mean, rather than having them mail you a statement of their credit card or mail you a statement of some interaction that you're having with them, they ask for your permission to send it to them, for them to send it to you as email on the basis of this being more green or environmentally conscious because it doesn't use paper. It's all electronic. Well, again, it's true that it doesn't use paper, and in that way, it reduces the environmental impact of the billing cycle. However, it also happens to directly coincide with the organization spending less money. So on the one hand, it's a win-win. On the other hand, it's a greenwashing claim if the only thing that the business is doing that's environmentally sensitive or environmentally conscious is the things that also happen to lower its costs. The final example is the grocery bag example. Now, if you go into a grocery store and they decide that they're no longer going to provide bags, paper bags or plastic bags to put your groceries in, and instead they're going to charge you for those bags or grocery bags, but if you bring in your own reusable grocery bags, then you can use those without any cost. That could be greenwashing, because what they've done is that they've lowered their cost by no longer providing bags, paper or plastic or otherwise, and instead asking you to bring your own bags. So yes, it's true that in this process, asking people to use reusable grocery bags, they've reduced the number of disposable bags that are being created and used by their organization. On the other hand, it also directly coincides with lowering their costs. So if the only thing that the grocery store is doing to benefit the environment happens to be things that are lowering their cost, then it's greenwashing. It's purporting that the rationale for what they're doing is an environmental motivation, when as a corporation, it's probably more driven by an economic concern. Now, let me put a caveat in here. Just because organizations are doing this doesn't mean that they are or aren't environmentally concerned or making environmental initiatives. It's just that these things by themselves don't justify a company as being environmental. Another point is that sometimes companies will do these things not because they want to, but because they're forced to. So there are some places, for example, where using plastic bags at the grocery store has been banned, and so by regulation. And so in that case, if a store says you must bring in reusable grocery bags, it may not be because they even chose to go green or claim they were going green. It may be through activists and through regulations and through popular pressure has forced a company in order to adopt a more environmental practice. All right. So how can you spot greenwashing? Well, if you see a green ad, you can take a look at the you have to take a look at the company as a whole. Can you easily find more information about their sustainable business practices on their website, for example? That'd be a good place to go. And when you go there, do they have a comprehensive environmental story that governs their entire business operation and everything they do? And you know, gut check here, is the information that they're saying believable? I mean, you know, can you even as a moderately educated environmental person, substantiate the green claims that you saw in the ad? And if not, then you have to be skeptical of what they're saying. So in order to actually do this, you can just Google the word, Google the name of the company that you're working with, and maybe add the word environment to the end of it and see what pops up. Because a lot of times in that search, you will find critical assessments of things that the company is doing, and some way of assessing whether or not what they claim they're doing is actually being backed up by anything else. Now, this is far from scientific, but it's a real quick way for consumers to be able to figure out whether or not a claim is true or not. Great. So what else? When you analyze a greenwashing claim, if you want to go beyond just the Google approach of just throwing in the company name and environment, you should think about two different aspects of a greenwashing, proposed greenwashing scenario. You should think about first whether or not the claim is accurate. And so by that I mean, is the manufacturer making deceptive or misleading claims about the environmental impact of the action that they're taking? First, is it accurate? And secondly, is it meaningful? Even if the claim is true, does it make a difference in terms of what the organization is doing as a whole in the context of the claim, et cetera, et cetera? Now, fortunately, in 1998, the issue of straight up accuracy was taken care of by regulations and directives that were put forward by in the US, the problem was solved, by regulations that were put forward by the United States Federal Trade Commission that put out pretty good guidelines about whether or not what you can claim about the environmental impact of products and services. And so these were the 1998 FTC Green Guidelines. And this guide applies to environmental claims in labeling, in advertising, in promotional materials, and all other forms of marketing, whatever medium it is, online, offline, paper, whether directly or by implication, and it includes both the words and any symbols or brands or badges that they might put on, any product brand names that they use, or any other means. So it's comprehensive. And you know, when you dig into it, it's pretty good. And I kind of want to look at it a little bit and give you some place to go if you want to find out more. So this is a screenshot of the FTC's guidelines. And you can see that there's 17 different sections covering everything from general overview, general principles, all the way down to what people can say about renewable materials or carbon offset credits, whether or not you can claim something as compostable. What are the guidelines about whether or not you can claim that for your particular product? So I'd like to look through a few of those. So first, starting off with the general principles, there are four general principles that the FTC was trying to address in creating these guidelines. And again, this is about accuracy of a green claim. So first of all, qualifications and disclosures. The idea about qualifications and disclosures was to prevent deceptive claims, qualifications, and disclosures. They should be clear, prominent, and understandable. And to make disclosures clear and prominent, marketers should use plain language, sufficiently large type. They should place their disclaimers in close proximity to the qualified claim. So if you have something on an ad, there better be the qualifications, if necessary, nearby. They should avoid making inconsistent statements or using distracting elements that could undercut or contradict the disclosure. The second point is that they have to make a distinction between the benefits of the product, the packaging of the product, or the service that's behind the product and packaging. So unless it's clear from the context, an environmental marketing claim has to specify which of these it applies to: product, packaging, service, portion of the product, packaging, or portion of the service. And in general, if the environmental attribute applies to all but minor inconsequential components of the product or package, the marketer then doesn't need to qualify that claim because it is assumed that it applies to everything. There are, however, exceptions to this general principle. For example, if they make an unqualified recyclability claim and the presence of a small incidental component makes the thing not 100% recyclable, then you know, if an organization claims that a product is recyclable, but there's something about that product that's small but prevents it from practically actually being recyclable, that would be deceptive. So imagine you had some futuristic cardboard phone, which however contains a battery that you can't take out. You can't just drop that cardboard phone into a recycling bin because the battery's in it, and that would ruin its ability to be recyclable. So you can't claim that. Third covers the overstatement of environmental attributes. So an environmental marketing claim can't overstate, either directly or by implication, an environmental attribute or benefit. And so marketers shouldn't state or imply environmental benefits if those benefits are negligible. And finally, the directives cover comparative claims. So those are things where you say that your environmental impact or the benefits of this product are better than some other product. So they have to be clear about exactly what they're comparing their current formulation, their current product, their current packaging, their current service to. And marketers have to have substantiation for the comparison. So they have to have the facts in order to claim that thing.